Finally, I'd like to summarize other nonlinear heart rate variability measures. Given the limited time, I am not going to go into all the other alternative nonlinear measures in great detail, but the one that has probably received the most attention is multiscale entropy. Multiscale entropy assesses the regularity of the signals, and it's done over multiple scales. And how regularities is assessed is by using something called sample entropy. And sample entropy assesses the relationship, sort of the consecutive ordering of the data. So in this case, you take a look at these first two points and you identify in the subsequent data sets later on is to see, like, where do you see similar relationships occur? And so you can see that you have one occur here and another one occur here. But then you could also see for the third point in this relationship, you see something that's blue here. And so you try to see, again, do you see the same subsequent ordering in the other identical sets? And you don't see that here, and so this one's not included, but this one certainly has that third consecutive point which matches this. And so the sample entropy is essentially out of the two possibilities of similar options, you have one that appears similar like this. So the lower number of similarities that you have compared to the available options will lead to a higher overall sample entropy. So a higher sample entropy is attributed to greater irregularity of the signal. And you do the same approach, but you do this across multiple scales, again, similar to the DFA scaling as well. And what you get is a graph such as this, and this is an example of one which was taken from Physical Review's letter in 2002. You have healthy individuals, which is represented by this green graph, atrial fibrillation in this graph, and then congestive heart failure in the circle graph here. So atrial fibrillation individual tends to have a lot of the irregularity occur in the high frequencies, but then as you sort of go out into the lower frequencies, then you start losing that irregularity. However, for congestive heart failure, you tend to have low amounts of regularity across all temporal scales in both low and high frequencies. And the healthy individuals, however, maintains high amount of irregularity across all temporal scales. And this could be extended to differentiating between the young and elderly. Young individuals have an overall greater irregularity or sample entropy across all the time scales compared to the elderly. So if you take a sum of all these values across all the scales, the sum MSE or the multiscale entropy tends to be larger in the young individuals compared to the elderly. Another nonlinear measure methodology is the symbolic dynamics. Symbolic dynamics, just like MSE, does care about the consecutive ordering of the RR interval data. But they use symbols in order to describe sort of the patterns that we see here. And you could see, for instance, there are different patterns here, some that has very low variability, one that sort of maintains some consistency, but then later some variation, and then one that has variations in both consecutive measurements. And what this study published in 2005 by Gazzetti showed that those individuals with higher numbers of zero variants tend to be more prone to arrhythmias compared to those who did not get arrhythmias. Another type of relationship or type of methodology is the Poincare plot analysis. What this does is you map out one RR interval, compared it to the subsequent RR interval. And from this graph, you get these plots, and you try to extract the elliptical fit for that. And then you extract SD1, which is the short axis for this ellipse, and the SD2 is the long axis of the ellipse. From my perspective, Poincare plot is most useful for detecting noise or ectopic beats. And this is an example of why you could detect these ectopic beats. you normally have these normal beats, which have usual RR interval, but then when you have an ectopic atrial beat, you have a short RR followed by a long RR interval. So as a result of that, this short RR may be mapped out in this region here, and then it's followed by a larger RR interval. And so you could see these possible ectopic beats. And then certainly this large one is followed by a regular one, so you could get another ectopic beat or another plot in this region as well. In truth, SD1 and SD2 can be derived by using just simple time domain measures. SD1 squared, for instance, is equal to 1/2 of standard deviation of standard deviation squared. This is a time domain measure. SD2 can also similarly be derived using just time domain measures itself. So you do not necessarily have to plot these graphs out in order to get SD1 or SD2. So here are my personal thoughts on nonlinear heart rate variability. Enthusiasm, in truth, has faded over recent years, and there are a number of factors for that. First, you need long-term recordings, and if you remember for power loss, 1/f slope, and specifically, it's required at least 24 hours of data, and that also remains true of DFA alpha-1. And the other reasons why enthusiasm has faded is that a lot of the study has been limited to centers with advanced knowledge in engineering computer science. In fact, most of the studies that were done, and the major studies done for DFA alpha-1 were done in Finland, particularly by the University of Oulu and medical center there. So, you know, there are very few other centers that did look into this in great detail, but not too many. The other limiting factor is it's quite sensitive to adjustable parameters and pre-processing and denoising steps. That's something that needs to be elaborated further. There's also limited info about reproducibility, probably due to some of these adjustable parameters, but also due to noise from the signals itself. And probably the biggest problem in regards to nonlinear heart rate variability is it's difficult to understand from a physiological standpoint. What is attributing to a Brownian noise or a white noise signal, for instance, is something that we have not fully established yet. And for this reason, it's unclear how clinical care is going to be changed. Like, what can we do to improve it? If we really don't understand the physiological basis for it, then it makes it hard for us to figure out what to target in order to treat it accordingly. But from my opinion, there's clearly something there. We've seen that nonlinear heart rate variability measures have often outperformed the traditional heart rate variability measures when it regards to mortality in a number of situations and conditions. And we're seeing that, you know, nonlinear measures are being increasingly available and accessible to ordinary citizens by apps and data availability. And, you know, I think the intra-individual day-to-day variations will likely yield personal specific information. As I mentioned, this is an area that has been understudied. The dynamic changes that we see in heart rate variability, not only of the traditional, but also the fractal-related measures, have not really been evaluated in great detail. And just like the application that we saw for lactate thresholds for exercise, I think the same can be extended to many other conditions. And it's an understudied area. And with the availability of wearables and apps and et cetera, there's going to be, I would predict, much more activity in this area. And DFA alpha and these fractal scales and nonlinear measures can potentially reveal insights into energy allocation distribution across organ systems. The theory behind a lot of these measures is that you have a heart that is sensitive to systems that operate across multiple timescales. So, you know, for respiration that operates in certain scales, higher scales, you have baroreflex that operates in lower frequencies, then you have thermal regulation and renin angiotensin, which operates at the, you know, very low frequencies, etc. So if you have a heart that functions well, it operates as all across all these scales, and the nonlinear measures should do a particularly good job of assessing all across those scales. And I think as we pay more and more attention to positive health and not just purely on disease, some of these nonlinear measures, which, you know, track much better to positive health overall, will, you know, receive much more attention. So I think there's a lot of excitement in nonlinear heart rate variability, and it's something that I think we should pay attention to in the future. So hopefully you could see why I presume that heart rate variability can be used as a marker of body-wide function. First, it has been applied in ecologically consistent environments. It's obtained in usual living, free-running conditions. There's no need for controlled settings. And the other thing is that there is no single temporal scales. The heart interacts across different organs with different time scales. And we've seen this in particularly with the fractal measures. And the heart rate variability measures certainly focus on dynamic patterns that emerge across multiple time scales. So comparison to the 1980s and 1990s, where the focus was primarily on autonomic nervous systems, the heart rate variability started to focus now on the human body overall and its function in usual day-to-day living. So I think from this perspective, this is why I think heart rate variability serves as a marker of body-wide function.